coffee and quickly caught the eye of the drink seller.
She had met this young man. His name was Scott Henson, very attractive. Well, Christine, being an attractive young woman, she meets this good-looking guy. That's kind of exciting for a young girl. It's kind of romantic.
Chrissy's girlfriends told police about Scott early on, but since he didn't fit the description of their prime suspect, investigators set him aside.
Chrissy told me they exchanged phone numbers so they can possibly meet up with us later on.
While they never got together as a group, Chrissy's friends say the two did go for a moonlit stroll on the beach that Friday night. Investigators wondered if an innocent get-together set Chrissy up for a deadly liaison.
You know, we're looking at the skyline where his whereabouts may she die.
Luckily, detectives don't have to go far to find the young man. He's already pouring cocktails for the dinner crowd.
When investigators meet Scott Henson, they ask him some questions about that Friday night that he says he didn't remember. You know, meeting this young, attractive girl, Christine. And yes, if he remembers that they took a walk on the beach, they talked, they exchanged phone numbers, and he thought that she was very nice, but that was it. He never saw her again.
Scott realizes the raven-haired beauty he met that night is the murdered spring breaker everyone's talking about. But the young man swears he had nothing to do with her death. He left town Saturday morning to celebrate Easter weekend with family 6 hours away in Georgia.
He wasn't even in town. The night that Christine, disappeared for some, there was another event.
Detective police dread sharing this news with Chrissy's family and friends.
Very disappointing, but it's a roller coaster ride for everybody who can be so close to thinking you're so close to something and finding out.
About 3 weeks into the investigation, police fear that the case is going to go in a direction which is the worst thing that can happen to a case that goes cold.
When April fades into May, friends and family worry Chrissy's killer may never be caught. He could be out of the state and killed by a victim. Anyway, I go find someone. Okay, what do you do?
How do you ever find someone? Not for sure, though, it would never be solved.
4 months after her murder, Chrissy's family posts a $1,000 reward, hoping to coax people to come forward with any information.
Police sometimes suggest to families that, maybe you could put a reward out there that'll, click in somebody's head and say, well, for $1,000, I'll tell you who the killer is.
Unfortunately, the promise of easy money doesn't light up the phones of the PD. Several weeks pass, frustrating everyone involved in the case.
Been in the news, we're asking everybody to bounce down for it. It's just nothing has to do. It's just hope that something will come up somewhere, sometime.
At this point, even though they hate to say it, the case is cold, but it just hits a wall.
I tell you that already. And we put in a lot of work on this for our sake.
As months turn into years, Chrissy's family and friends have only hope and faith to sustain them.
You sit back and you wait. You lean up the hands of God, and that's all you can do. Meanwhile, you go through it. The more you can breathe it. Of the loss is really tricky when you cut.
An excruciating wait with a surprise ending no one sees coming.
17 years after Christine was already murdered, in April of 2010, the sheriff's office gets a telephone call. It's learned that somebody had come forward finally after so many years and said that he had shot her.
Scott's not getting a rabbit grass. He was 2 times faster than sea level for 4 feet of grass. And everything else just seems slow.
It's the odd season. Let's get to the bed.
All I'm trying to get is sleep on a purple mattress.
If the only mattress good for every doctor in the way places where the needles and handcuffs instant response for the undisturbance, it's soft to push it away.
Firm to support and keep your spine erect, thanks to Ripple's grip.
And I can finally sleep.
Goodbye.
to do for you. I would not call.
Find your kids. Find energy. Protein, fruit stuff, veggie stuff, confidence stuff, protein roots, milk fruit, and carrot peas. Hello, people. I can't read this right. Find it in V8. That's nice.
It's been nearly 2 decades since Chrissy Lazaro's killer disappeared into the darkness outside Daytona Beach, Florida. Despite the agonizing wait for her arrest, Chrissy's family and friends still hope to be found.
I truly believe that her heart, that if some information would come up, it would put this arrest close to her. Wonder how long?
Detective Jody Palermo retired years ago. He too hopes the Volusia County Sheriff's Office will get justice for the spring breaker from Rochester who never made his home.
This particular case, among the cases that Harvey Lincoln seems out, and this is what you're asking.
I don't think the investigators ever forget that the people who are closest to the case always have that glimmer of hope that something's going to happen.
Sure enough, on April 20th, 2010, 17 years after Chrissy's murder, the sheriff's office gets an interesting call from 4 states away. On the other end of the line, a warden from the Louisiana State Penitentiary. Turns out one of his inmates, Ramallah Gordon, who's already serving back-to-back life sentences for killing 2 women, just confessed to another murder.
He wrote a letter to the warden, told the warden that Molly was in Daytona Beach. Imagine that if you had Easter Sunday, you killed a girl and you named her.
He could remember the girl's last name somewhat. He thought that the last name was Lazarus, but he said that he had shot her in the head twice and left her by the side of the road.
Stunned Florida detectives believe that Gordon is actually the murderer to Christine Lazaro. And when investigators run a quick check on the career criminal, it sure seems he's telling the truth about Chrissy. Turns out, years before he murdered the 2 women in Louisiana, he stirred up some trouble in the Sunshine State.
The sheriff's office found out that the government began to use arresting on his trial, not the trespass trial.
While the arrest went down 2 months after Christine's murder, Gordon was taken into custody just 40 miles from the river, the site of Christine's shooting. Not only that, when police slapped the cuffs on him, Gordon was carrying a 38 caliber pistol, the same type of weapon used to kill Christine. Hoping the gun is still in evidence, detectives made the 45-minute drive south.
Unfortunately, the gun was found and had been destroyed. There were 9 seconds marked as crushed to my head and I knew.
Luckily, the investigators know where to find Gordon, so they head to Louisiana to make sure he's their man. At first glance, Gordon's face seems similar to the man in the sketch, but his hairdo is different, so investigators still have some work to do.
Police have to make sure it's not just someone who's making this up for, fame or war, so they ask him certain questions that have not been publicized.
Once Gordon starts talking about that awful night, there's no doubt he's Chrissy's killer. Gordon claims he was simply out in the bar looking for a good time.
Well, regardless, Gordon and Chrissy Lazaro, they start talking and everything came off, and he told police that he actually liked her a lot.
Determined to spend time with a brunette beauty, Gordon claims to be someone he's not.
Well, the old lady was a wealthy record producer, and she ended up going with his dad.
After partying and razzing at the Santa One Club, Gordon says the two had a bite to eat, then went back to his hotel room in the bedroom. While Chrissy made a quick call to her boyfriend, Gordon claims he stepped out of the room. When he returned, things went sour.
He had gone into the bathroom, but when he came out, he saw Christine going through some of his stuff, and she had found various fake IDs.
Would Chrissy find out he was living in Florida under a false name on the run from Louisiana? massage.
Well, he was extremely paranoid, and he thought that Christine was going to join the band, so he had to do it.
He said, when I take you back to the Palm Beach, we just drove down the little state and pulled off with the exit.
But it's not. He makes it to Daytona.
He drove like this. He coming out of the car.
Before Chrissy knows what's happening, Gordon shoots her twice in the head. First in the ear, and then in the jaw.
She probably didn't hear what was coming. I'm hoping she didn't know what was coming. I wish I had thought about it.
Gordon's surprise confession finally brings the case full circle for Chrissy's family and friends.
When I'm listening to the detective, this is kind of an effort for this. But, the young man, don't be honest,
just confessing.
Say what?
It brought me right back to the day we found out. That nauseating feeling and crying, shaking, and how could he, why? Everything.
Before Gordon's day in court, he writes Chrissy's father, asking for forgiveness.
I wish I could have heard quite some time. Who am I? You know everybody's judging. I forgive him.
A decision that doesn't come as easily for Chrissy's friends.
Yeah, you confess, and you're sorry to the world. It's all okay. You can never get this back. You can say sorry all you want, but it's all okay. Thank you for your confession, but I want you to pay for taking our friend. I want you to pay for taking a life.
And pay he does. On May 25th, 2011, Pomodoro scored the king's guilty to Chris's murder. Is given a third life sentence at Louisiana's annual prison.
I'm very happy for the family. This resolution. I'm happy for myself as long as I work hard. And the best thing of all of this is this dude had us to that event. He's where it belongs.
Chrissy's loved ones miss her terribly. Coping with their grief by focusing on the little time they did have with everyone's favorite poet from Rochester.
She would like to fall. So we see that a lot. She's a gentleman. She's a very nice, outgoing person that always, you were always comfortable about. She'll be hard on fun. And bringing the fun out of me, too. She's just a bubbly, happy, friendly, trusting person. Will always remember her like that.
I'm proud of her. I'm proud of who she was, what I was, she touched me. That was my girl.
A dream of ends in a nightmare. When a pretty monkey is viciously attacking in her own home.
Because they're occupied with hope in a way that there's a struggle, it would strangle her more. This is a scary crime, it's one that has shocked them.
How's the mind and its health runs by broken heart?
I was starving. It's the most painful thing I've ever been through.
Who had it for cancer and why? Police quickly zero in on several suspects, including Kelsey's husband.
As you see, that the husband didn't say anything else other than matters.
Detectives follow the money, and it pays off in spades. What lies behind the moment of defenses? city of Milford, Connecticut is steeped in New England charm. But it's more down home than some of the upscale areas along the Long Island Sound. Just the place for laid-back Kelsey Monahan.
How's it like the beach? Yeah. The sound of the waves and collecting seashells and just that atmosphere that comes with you for the beach.
The 28-year-old biologist took up residency here in the spring of 1998. After growing up in landlocked Old Brick, New Jersey, the move brought her the coastal lifestyle she craved, and new husband to boot.
I was playing in a restaurant in Goldberg, and she didn't see me. I remember this white shirt from behind her, and she had this blonde hair, and this kind of like all curly, and she was beautiful.
Kelsey's life forever changed when she locked eyes with California transplant, Matt Monahan. A gym equipment salesman and aspiring performer.
From what she's told me, they fell in love at first sight, or she fell in love with him that night, and the rest was history.
Now, after 2 years of quiet bliss, the couple plans to put down roots just steps from the sand and surf. Tired of their cramped walk-up, they recently landed a good real estate deal on, of all places, Bittersweet Avenue.
We were waiting in the apartment, and the house woman on the market, we just asked about it because it was kind of run down, but it had potential. So we ended up getting it for a really great price, and that was a dream.
A dream house that in 8 months will be filled with a big pile of little feet.
It's just fun if you ever surprised. I was very awesome. But pain, and I was happy that I was living on a baby.
Seems like Kelsey has it all. A loving husband, new home, and now a baby on the way. However, little does she know, her sweet life will soon have a bitter ending. Memorial Day weekend 2001 is an unusual one in Milford. A sudden dip in temperature has kept locals and visitors out of the water. And to make matters worse, trouble's brewing on land as well. At 8 o'clock Friday night, resident Matt Monahan makes a frantic call to police.
I went to the wife's home last night. I don't know what happened. When I came home, you found Kelsey's wife bound with rope and almost dead. The way she was being strangled with the rope was set in a way that she was hogtied and in which they were strangled or worse.
Milford Police Detective Steve Wydra is enjoying the night off when he learns of the terrifying incident at the Monahan's apartment.
It's just a location you really didn't expect to have on a major assault or film. It's a quiet area most of the time, not a lot of activity in there. Would you believe that it was someone who knew the Monahan's?
The city fire department dispersed on the scene, with police and crime scene techs right on the heels. They find Kelsey lying still on the floor, in the middle of an area the couple uses for storage. While husband Matt watches helplessly, the firemen struggle to revive Kelsey.
Kelsey was folded in the face and strangled with the rope. We kind of knew it didn't look good coming together.
Although the emergency workers managed to get a heartbeat, Kelsey was barely breathing. They can't get her to the hospital fast enough.
She was taken to Bridgeport Hospital, 10-15 minutes away. Bridgeport Hospital deals with trauma type cases.
While Kelsey struggles to survive, investigators send the rope that was around her neck to the lab and try to figure out how such an ugly thing could happen to so beautiful a woman right in her own home.
The intruder came into the house and now ransacked the house.
Husband Matt tells police he was only gone an hour, leaving Kelsey to run an errand.
My wife being in the hospital to help him move a stairmaster up to the seventh floor of his girlfriend's house. It's really not far from where I live.
When he returned, Matt claims he was stunned to find his wife unconscious on the floor, and immediately grabbed his pocket knife to try and flee her.
This hot girl wants to go ahead. Just so don't leave me. Come back, don't go away, come back.
Jesse then tried to revive Cassie using CPR. When that failed, he called for help. Investigators plan to speak to Mal further, but first they take a look around and quickly find a telltale clue just inches from where Kelsey was tied up.
We noticed that there was a safe in the room that had the door open. It looked like someone had gone through it.
Last time we checked, Matt says he and Kelsey had about $1,000 cash in that vault.
That big girl's in there, so it would spend up and down. But bonuses I got from water and stuff like that.
But sifting through the safe, detectives find only legal papers and letters.
He led us to believe that it was a homeless agent that the intruder knew he was looking for, and Kelsey was going home at the time, and that he could easily get her to give him the combination of the safe by assaulting her.
After inspecting the doors and windows, police conclude that the first motive was burglary. Probably wasn't random.
There was no forced entry into the house. We believe Kelsey let the intruder probably believe that she either knew them or was not a threat.
This gets the veteran detectives wondering if that someone, possibly the man right in front of them,
said they were on the other side.
Matt had a disposition that he didn't seem overly concerned that his wife was assaulted in the hospital, and the story that he had to move some exercise equipment for his brother. The story that we need to confirm to see if we can prove him out as a suspect in this case.
When the lawman asked Matt to drive back to the station with them, nothing could have been curious.
Back when I was going to the police station, my wife was in the hospital, tells me that this woman could have been in these guys or something.
Either Kelsey's husband is coping with grief and his own peculiar way, or something far more sinister has washed up on the Earthly shores. Just as suspicious of Matt.
my original thought was that it had to be the husband. We have heard so many things about that. He definitely had a past, like, you know, this party lifestyle. That he had a lot of different odd jobs. We've heard a lot of negative stuff about him.
Oh, we're worried about him. Oh, look, we're worried about him. Suspicious.
At Matt and Kelsey's apartment, investigators continue to process the crime scene. After combing through every nook and cranny of the couple's duplex, finally, in the living room, hidden at the bottom of a weathered truck, they find something that cements their case.
We discovered that a book that explained tie knots and how tie knots works.
In fact, the old hardback illustrates how to make dozens of complicated knots. Looking through the pages, detectives land on an entire section devoted to making the dangerous type of knots used on Kelsey.
The hard tying of Kelsey is not something that an average person would know how to tie knots. It's very intricate knot that she was tied in. So we knew that that person had to have a better than average knowledge of knot tying.
Investigators present husband Matt with the incriminating book and demand an explanation.
Yes. My issue.
I told him Kelsey got that from one of her relatives, and I don't even remember. It was an ex-punk full of family stuff. I don't remember what it was.
A storm of detectives on the bomb. Frustrated, police try a different tack. They quiz Matt about the open safe, asking if anyone else knew about it or had the combination.
Who's one of these
guys who said, was the one that could open it? I was a police woman, I didn't ever know what the combination was. So she had to open it up.
Although the explanation is plausible, the silent lawman wondered if there's more to the story. Could there be another reason Kelsey was keeping the husband from the cash?
You think that does something about Matt a little more? Who's your money to? Is he involved in the drugs? And would that mean Matt wanna either assault his wife or have someone assault her for him?
He would have to lie.
No, Matt.
Matt balks at this insinuation, but the line of questioning does spark his memory about a recent incident.
Matt says a few days before this girl would be
the mom in that store. But I thought it was the picture that caused me to hire
it.
So I seen the t-shirt with my face and going up there.
The mystery man then asked Matt if he knew a woman named Erica Reno. Matt claims he called a surprise visitor who was an old friend he hadn't seen in months. That's when the conversation got even stranger.
That you owe her money? And I said, I think I do. She thinks I owe her money to cover her funding. You know, it's not separate. Except,
before Matt could get any more information, he says Anthony turned to leave, mumbling, "I must be mistaken." Matt tells police he watched the curious caller drive off in a black car. Then, like any good husband, he immediately went upstairs to tell his wife about the odd encounter.
Kelsey felt a little threatened by it, really wanted Matt to put it on record with police, just so that they would be aware that this guy did come to their house and ask for money.
Matt debated whether to call long-lost pal Erica first and ask her about Anthony's surprise visit. But Kelsey insisted he go straight to her for PD and file a complaint. So good. Matt has a sick feeling this stranger may have something to do with Kelsey's attack.
This is the joy. And I don't create any issues. It's all good.
Detectives aren't sure what to think of the bizarre turn.
It was a weird occurrence that someone goes to his house and say you're dead. And then walk away.
And as Matt continues, the story just doesn't ring true.
Suspicious of some of his answers and some things that he's tempted to hide.
detectives are especially wary of the curious complaint that filed just before the attack. The report says the officer Matt spoke to followed up with his friend, Erica Reba, at her Beaufort home.
So when we interviewed Erica, she said that she was Matthew, but there was a conflict in her stories where Matt says that he's not owing money to Erica, and Erica said the opposite, saying that Matt did owe somewhere over $1,000 to her.
So the officer asked Erica point blank, and she sent a man named Anthony over to the Monahans to clean up the debt.
He said to the department, she was adamant in her denial that she knew anybody named Anthony or that she had sent a friend over to the Monahans house asking for money.
On his way out, the officer spotted a black car with street tags parked on the street. Since visitors from the Midwest are not uncommon in Milford, he added the plate number to his report. The initial officer didn't know what to make of the conflicting stories and was skeptical about the event not reported.
The police thought that it was suspicious that Kelsey didn't go down with them to file a police report, that it was Matthew on the job. So the question is, did somebody go to come to the door to those before us?
Police wonder if husband Matt is spinning in an outlandish yard to take a hit on himself, or if he's behind an assault for hire that went tragically wrong.
Somewhere out west, longer than it does now, and the cars and trucks pull its own path to where it's never done. It's followed along the road, and it got a lot of birds to eat. Followed along the road, expanded. You can hear the river talking. Same goes for the fish. It's kind of cold and dry. All the way around to one.
New Sensodyne Nourish nourishes and strengthens teeth with a bioactive mineral action. It also calms the nerve inside the tooth for sensitivity prevention. Invest in healthier teeth. New Sensodyne Nourish.
Saturday, Memorial Day weekend 2001, was far from festive for Kelsey Monahan and her family. Just yesterday, the expected mom was picking out paint for her new home. Now, she languishes on life support after being brutally beaten and strangled, while loved ones praying for her recovery.
And the doctor says the medicine is keeping her alive. You know, there's no brain activity at all. Everybody's just hoping that maybe by a miracle she can come back to life.
Milford, Connecticut police are hoping for a breakthrough of their own. Kelsey's husband, Matt.
Tell me about your wife. Did you call your wife off the road?
Detectives have their suspicions, but they don't have a shred of hard evidence against Matt. However, before letting him go, they make a quick call to his brother, Kenny. The person Matt claimed to be with, Kelsey was brutally assaulted.
Let me know.
As expected, Danny wholeheartedly corroborates Matt's alibi.
It's always tough for alibi as a family member, because family members love you no matter what you do, so they're gonna stick their neck out for you, you know, lie for you.
Although police plan to investigate husband Matt further, at this point, they have no choice but to release him.
Because all this is so hard.
By the next day, word of the horrific attack has run rampant throughout the seaside community.
This is a scary crime. These officers were approached by residents wanting to know if there was a stalker in the area. Should they lock their doors? Should they be more careful? When someone comes in and assaults a young female who is pregnant, shocked up.
So investigators waste no time trying to drum up fresh leads. Police cordon off the entire neighborhood, has stopped every vehicle and pedestrian coming in or out.
Please were asking the neighbors to be suspicious. See a car in the driveway. See people running around with the back door.
As another neighbor's back of brains trying to help detectives.
You'll also see there's a watermark installed on this, and this is the watermark here. It's our college logo, which you can. Make any size you like and move around the screen into a suitable place, but I'm going to place it on the bottom right. And this means that when this creates the video, this watermark will appear throughout your PowerPoint presentation, which I think is quite useful. I've also created a blank screen just so I can have it on the screen in front of me without either of the videos running. So when I've used OBS in previous tutorials, I've set it up to record the video to the desktop, and I'm going to be using that functionality again now. So, making sure that I've got my blank slide to start with, the start, the content, and the end set up as four different scenes with the correct sources.
Working tirelessly to try and find out who, how, and why this tragic.
very, very quiet about this. No one knew if this was a targeted prompt or if this was just a random act of violence. They implored police to stop this quickly.
Thankfully, detectives are already questioning two individuals who just might have something to do with Kelsey's murder. Tyler Carroll and his sales partner, Carroll and Green. Neighbors believe the pair may have been in a black car the day Kelsey was attacked. With Tyler's drug history, investigators believe the Monahan safe full of cash.
Learn how to spend it. Third, along the way.
Maybe
Although Matt is quiet, he's growing tired of detective suspicions.
We've all got insurance and everything in order. We got houses and each other.
And as for the cosmetics,
I had implants, but in 6 months of the war, we saw my cousin and had to go for your bone and roll out of the tunnel. And after a dozen murder,
trying to keep his cool, Matt swears up and down that he never hurt his beloved cousin with his mother in law agrees.
I never, ever thought I had anything to do with it. I could go up to their house and stay with them many times. I could see the love they had for one another. You could see it, you could feel it. You know how that is when you're with somebody you love, everybody knows it.
And it turns out Matt's DNA does not match the blood found on the rope that was wrapped around his wife's neck. Greatly relieved, the widower is anxious to move on.
The police are doing their job. They did a good job for what they should have. It's called, past this, and it gets to the person who is responsible.
Husband Matt still insists that the mysterious debt collector, Anthony, who came to the door just days before Kelsey was attacked, is the culprit. Matt is convinced Anthony came back and stole the money he claimed Matt owed to their mutual friend, Erica.
That's why I filed a police report. You're right.
Detectives are starting to agree that the elusive Anthony might be to blame. Looking back through the report file, they spot the notation about a black car from Missouri parked on Erica's block, and on a hunch from the plate. Turns out the car is registered to Luis Antonio Rodriguez, and he has a rash of a mile long.
And Luis arrests probably about 25 for robberies, humiliations, assaults. We also learned that he was part of a well-known gang in that area, which also had branches out in Missouri.
Sure sounds like police might finally know Anthony's true identity. Luis Antonio did make another surprise visit to the Monahans. 41-year-old career Khan could have easily overtaken Kelsey to get to the couple's safe.
Knowing that Luis had a corruption, a lot of felonies, the police too, that they were obviously not afraid to strong arm people.
So police race over to Erica's. Luis's black sedan, spotted there by an officer just days ago, is no longer parked on the street outside their home. Detectives knock at the door, and Erica answers. So they give her another chance to talk, and she does.
Erica admits to knowing Luis Rodriguez, and had known him for a short time.
Erica confesses that the car belongs to Luis, and that he knew Matt owed her money. But she insists she never sent Luis to the Monahans. According to Erica, Luis left Milford around 8 that eventful night, and arrived home in Independence, Missouri the following evening.
Once we learned that Luis Rodriguez was out of Missouri, and he left Connecticut shortly after, he sent a couple detectives out to Missouri.
Once in the Midwest, the detectives quickly get their prime suspect to get them out of the police station.
We expected that he would claim to have no dealings with Matt and Kelsey, and that he was nowhere near the crime scene.
However, Luis calmly tells detectives that he did stop by the Monahan's home. But when Matt denied owing an old debt, Luis told Erica to hand over the problem to the courts. Luis insists that's the only trip he made to the Monahans.
He denied being part of this assault and homicide.
Police doubt Luis is telling the truth, so they reach out to the crime lab for help.
We were able to obtain a DNA sample from Luis Rodriguez that we could test against.
Once again, the results leave detectives. detective scrapped her their minds because Willis is not a match. As it turns out, there's another explanation.
We started looking in the house, and other people were on the scene. We later learned that the DNA was left by one of our detectives.
Apparently, the detective's bandage later accidentally bled on the rope when he put it in the evidence bag.
This rope DNA used to have a DNA that was.
And it seems, for now, so is their pursuit of Willis Antonio. The police keep him on their radar, but with nothing concrete tying him to the crime, they grudgingly let him go and head back to Connecticut.
That's what's frustrating. You got him in there, but he's living with it. You let him know, no evidence.
The summer comes and goes, and police have no new leads in Kelsey's case. Eventually, the passing seasons become years, and Kelsey's mom never gives up.
Every year I come out to see these people, just to let them know that somebody's out here supposed to know what's happening.
Just when it looks like Kelsey's attacker will never come, a hot tip draws the cold case. Police will soon be staring into the very eyes of the devil.
Yeah. finally.
I don't hold my breath for 10 years, you know, and they finally got this guy.
But the joy doesn't last long. Marcus finally admits he did mean to strangle and rob Kelsey. He swears he never meant to kill her, setting up his plan to plead guilty to manslaughter. Kelsey's husband, Matt, isn't buying his story either.
His whole manslaughter thing at first.
Despite Matt's outrage, in August 2013, Luis Rodriguez agrees to a plea deal and is sentenced to 20 years in prison without parole. But this term won't begin until after he serves out his stint in Oklahoma. Based on Lewis's confession, here's what police think went down at the big corner. 3 days after confronting Matt about the money he supposedly owed Frank and Earth, Reedy Lewis, aka Anthony, goes back to the Monahan's house, determined to find out what's in the safe. Possibly thinking the visitor was a painter, Kelsey opens the door to her worst nightmare.
Lewis Rodriguez forcibly enters his way into the house.
Lewis continues to beat Kelsey and forces her to unlock the safe. Once the vault's open, Lewis grabs $1,000 in cash, hogties Kelsey, and then flees in his black sedan to go party with her friends.
Kelsey, I'm sure, struggled to try to release herself from the vines and get able to flee and let her death.
With Lewis's confession, Kelsey's husband is completely exonerated once and for all.
Just a loving letter.
That is very
Thank you. Murdered by college students and for their rampage during the summer. is for children's eight-year-old sister, Sonia, and her delivery is still alive. The game is long since the victim of the absence. But what effect will all this have on the children?
I got a phone call from my sister, and she said something's happened to Sonia. She told me that Sonia was.
Yeah, that was awful.
I couldn't quite wrap my head around
it. She claims to have a weird and a horrible trauma at his sister's murder. That's why I didn't think about alcohol.
I was not thinking the good thoughts. I'm still dealing with my dad's sister. And if you're a mother of a 1-year-old, you're not going to just go on the way.
I called my sergeant. I told her that there's a lot more to this missing person than it needs to hide. And my sergeant said, let's go ahead and call homicide and get this thing out of the room. Orange County Sheriff's Detective John Wooden, a 16-year veteran of the force, takes the case.
We don't get too many people on a mother that just disappear. So it was one of those ones that, you know,
And when Detective Leonard questions Jim, he picks up on his strange.
Jim is jumping towards